أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. The verses that we have read so far, you may have noticed that shukr and sabr and ihsan came together, because all of them are related with each other. A person cannot do shukr unless and until he does sabr, and a person cannot do sabr unless and until he does shukr. Both go hand in hand. How? When we cannot do shukr over what we have, then how can we have sabr over what we don't have? If you don't look at what you have, then what are you going to do? You're going to complain about what you don't have. But if a person is grateful about what he has, then automatically he'll have sabr over what he doesn't have. So both of them go hand in hand. And this is the quality of someone who does ihsan. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِن تُطِيعُوا الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا يَرُدُّوكُمْ عَلَىٰ أَعْقَابِكُمْ فَتَنْقَلِبُوا خَاسِرِينَ. O you who have believed, if you obey those who disbelieve, they will turn you back on your heels and you will then become losers. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, in tuti'u. Tuti'u is from ita'a, to obey someone, to comply with someone. Whatever they say, you obey them. So if you obey alladhina kafaru, those people who have disbelieved, whether these disbelievers are of the Yahud and the Nasara, or they are the Mushrikeen, or they are the Munafiqoon, if you obey them, if you listen to them. What does it mean by this? If you listen to them, with regards to what? With regards to the matters of your deen. If you obey them, then what's going to happen? يَرُدُّوكُمْ عَلَىٰ أَعْقَابِكُمْ. Then you're going to turn back on your heels, meaning you're going to go away from Islam. You're going to turn back to kufr. Now, when it comes to obedience to the disbelievers, obedience to those people who don't believe, we are not allowed to obey them in the matters of religion. But when it comes to the matters of this world, then we have the choice. For instance, if you go to a doctor who is not a Muslim, and he's telling you to take a particular medicine, you're going to say, no, you're a disbeliever, I'm not going to take it? Huh? If your professor is a non-Muslim, and they're telling you about something, they've asked you to do your homework, you're going to say, no? No. When it comes to the worldly affairs, then we must listen to them. If what they're saying is good for us, if what they're saying is actually correct for us. But if what they're telling us contradicts our deen, is against our deen, then we must not listen to them. For example, you go to, you know, someone who's very good in fitness, right? You go to a gym and you have a personal trainer, right? And it's the month of Ramadan, and he says to you, don't fast because you have to drink water after every 2 hours. Huh? Are you going to listen to them? No, you're not going to. Even though they're telling you something that may be beneficial for you otherwise, outside of Ramadan, but because the hukm of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes, then you're not going to listen to them. So if you listen to them in the matters of religion, then what's going to happen? يَرُدُّوكُمْ عَلَىٰ أَعْقَابِكُمْ. They're going to turn you back on your heels, meaning they will make you revert to unbelief. They will make you leave your religion. Eventually, you're going to leave your religion. You're not going to progress in your faith, rather you're going to regress, you're going to turn backwards. فَتَنْقَلِبُوا خَاسِرِينَ. And as a result, if you turn back on your heels, if you abandon Islam, then what's going to happen? You're going to become losers. تَنْقَلِبُوا from inqilab, قَافْ لَنْبَى. You will become losers. Meaning, after having Islam, which is when a person is a Muslim, when a person is a believer, then he is gaining profit, he's gaining benefit. Like in Surah Al-Asr, وَالْعَصْرِ إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرِ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. So a believer is gaining profit, he's not in loss. And if a person leaves his iman and goes towards kufr, then he is in khasara. Then he is going to incur loss. Where? In this world as well as the hereafter. This ayah was revealed in a particular context. We learned that when the 300 munafiqun, when the 300 hypocrites, when they left the Prophet ﷺ and did not proceed with him to Uhud, they went back to Medina, they also discouraged some of the Muslims from going along the Prophet ﷺ. Which is why earlier we read that إِذْ هَمَّ الطَّائِفَتَانِ مِنْكُمْ أَنْ تَفْشَلَ. Two groups of the Muslims who were about to lose hope. They were about to lose their heart. They were going to also listen to the hypocrites. So this ayah was revealed that if you listen to them, then what's going to happen? You're going to go back from your Islam to your kufr. You're not going to excel in your religion. You're going to go backwards in your religion. Secondly, it is said that when the Muslims returned from Uhud, then Abdullah ibn Ubay, he said that if Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a true prophet, then this wouldn't have happened. Then the Muslims would not have suffered defeat. So Allah is telling us over here that if you listen to these people, if you obey them, then what's going to happen? You're not going to remain firm upon your Islam. So what does it show to us? That when a person has decided to do something, when a person has started to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then he must remain firm. And no matter what people say, no matter how people discourage him, he must not listen to them. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, once he put on the armor, what did he do? He said it's not appropriate for a prophet that once he puts it on, he takes it off without fighting. فَإِذَا عَزَمْتَ فَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ. Once you have made up your mind, then trust upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then don't give up, no matter what people say, no matter what people do. Also we learn from this that a person, if he does kufr, then he is in loss. He is going to suffer great loss in this dunya and also in the akhirah. The only way that a person can be successful is when a person is a believer. And if a person listens to the kuffar, if a person is obedient to them, then definitely he is going to suffer in his deen. Definitely he is going to suffer in his deen. Okay, a person might not become a disbeliever, but he is going to stay behind in his deen. What did we learn earlier? That سَابِقُوا إِلَى مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَجَنَّةٍ عَرْضُهَا كَعَرْضِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to excel. سَابِقُوا, run, race towards. But if we listen to our enemy, if we listen to those people who don't want Jannah, then obviously we're not going to excel in our religion. We're going to go backwards in our religion. So Allah is warning us over here. بَلِ اللَّهُ مَوْلَاكُمْ وَهُوَ خَيْرُ النَّاصِرِينَ. But Allah is your protector and He is the best of helpers. He is your Mawla, meaning He is the one who helps you. So therefore, you should listen to Him, not your enemy. Don't obey those people who disbelieve, rather who should you obey? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَهُوَ خَيْرُ النَّاصِرِينَ. And He is the best of those who help. How is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the best of those who help? Because He is the one who is. He is the one who is most capable. He is Qadir. He is Aziz. He is Qawi. He is the one who has most strength. We learn in Surah Al-Imran, Ayah 160, that إِن يَنْصُرْكُمُ اللَّهُ فَلَا غَالِبَ لَكُمْ. If Allah should aid you, then no one can overcome you. Because He is خَيْرُ النَّاصِرِينَ. If Allah is going to help you, then no one can overcome you. No one can cause you defeat. وَإِن يَخْذُلْكُمْ فَمَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَنْصُرُكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ. But if He should forsake you, then who is there that can aid you after Him? وَعَلَى اللَّهِ فَلْيَتَوَكَّلِ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. And upon Allah, let the believers rely. So when a person makes, you know, a decision to do something for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then what happens? There is some difficulty. There are some challenges, sometimes from within and sometimes from without. What does Allah tell us over here? Don't listen to those people who are taking you away from obedience to Allah. Rather, have tawakkul and rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because بَلِلَّهُ مَوْلَاكُمْ. Allah is your Mawla. وَهُوَ خَيْرُ النَّاصِرِينَ. And He is the best of those who could aid you. Best of those who could assist you. So be confident about your deen. سَنُلْقِي فِي قُلُوبِ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا الرُّعْبَ بِمَا أَشْرَكُوا بِاللَّهِ مَا لَمْ يُنَزِّلْ بِهِ سُلْطَانًا. We will cast terror into the hearts of those who disbelieve. Why? Because of what they have associated with Allah, of which He has not sent down any authority. سَنُلْقِي. نُلْقِي is from lam qafiya, from the word liqa. Liqa is to meet, and ilqa is to throw, to cast, to hurl. So سَنُلْقِي, meaning we're going to put, we're going to throw, we're going to cast. And the scene over here, what does it show? Soon, as well as that it's a promise. So it gives meaning of qurb, and it also gives meaning of tahqiq, of certainty. So سَنُلْقِي فِي قُلُوبِ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. In the hearts of those people who disbelieve, we are going to put a rub, fear, awe. Rub is shiddatul khawf. It is extreme fear, alarm, panic, fright. It is said that rub is to be overwhelmed with fear and terror that makes a person lose his reason. It is when a person is overwhelmed with fear, He is overwhelmed with terror and he loses his reason. For instance, you're perfectly fine and all of a sudden you see somebody and you're scared of them. And what happens? You do something wrong, or you were going to say something, but in your confusion and your fear, you don't even realize about what you're saying. For instance, some people, they go to the group, they memorize their lesson, but when they see the group in charge, what happens? They forget their lesson. That is what ru'b is. That you are in so much awe and fear of the other person that you can't use your mind anymore. A person loses his reason. He's perfectly fine otherwise, but because he's in that situation in front of some person, that's it. He cannot use his mind anymore. So, سَنُوقِي فِي قُلُوبِ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا الرُّعْبَ. We will put fear into the hearts of those people who disbelieve. It is said that after departing from Uhud, the mushrikeen, they intended to return and finish all of the Muslims. If you think of it, they had just defeated the Muslims. So when they left Uhud, they intended that they should come back and attack the Muslims again and finish them off completely. You know, when your enemy is weak, when the enemy has just suffered a huge loss, that's the time to get the enemy. So they intended to do that. But then they got terrified and they did not return. But isn't it amazing? You just defeated them, but still you don't have the confidence to come and finish them. So this was the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He put ru'b in their hearts, ru'b of the Muslims in their hearts, that they didn't have the confidence to come and finish them, despite the fact that they had just defeated them. Why? How come they have this ru'b in their hearts? Bima ashraku billah. Because they have done shirk with Allah. Because they are worshipping idols who cannot even swat a fly away. Huh? If the fly takes something from them, they cannot even take something back from the fly. So if a person is worshipping an idol who is inanimate, how can such a person have confidence? If he is relying on something inanimate, how can he have confidence? So بِمَا أَشْرَكُوا بِاللَّهِ مَا لَمْ يُنَزِّلْ بِهِ سُلْطَانًا. مَا, that which لَمْ يُنَزِّلْ بِهِ سُلْطَانًا. Sultan is authority, and it's also used for evidence, it's also used for proof. Meaning Allah has not given anyone the authority that they should associate partners with Allah. And Allah has not sent down any evidence that He has partners. There is no evidence in the scripture that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has partners. So people have no authority to associate partners with Allah. So if a person commits a major crime, then what happens? He loses his confidence. If a person commits a major sin, what happens? He loses his confidence. For instance, if a person lies, then he doesn't have any confidence left. He has to keep swearing in order to make other people trust him. Isn't it so? And he has to keep assuring in different ways so that other people trust him. Because when a person commits sin, then he loses his confidence. وَمَأْوَاهُمُ النَّارِ. And their abode is hellfire. وَبِئْسَ مَثْوَى الظَّالِمِينَ. And how terrible is the abode of those people who do ظُلْم. What does ظُلْم over here mean? Shirk. Because إِنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ. مَأْوَى is from the root letters Hamza Wawiya. And أَوَى is to go join with someone. Awa is to take shelter. So ma'wa is a place where one takes shelter. It's an abode. A place where one lives. But it gives a meaning of shelter, meaning you don't have anywhere else to go. That's the only place that you can go. And the word mathwa is also used for abode. But what's the difference? Mathwa is from the root letters tha, waw, ya. And athwa bil makan is to stay at a particular place for a long time. What does it mean? To stay at a place, to reside in a place for a long time. So, ma'wa gives a meaning of shelter, that they have no other place to go, and mathwa means it's their permanent dwelling from which they will never leave. They have nowhere else to go, and this is their permanent abode. They're not going anywhere else. They cannot leave from here. Ma'wahumun nar wa bi'sa mathwa al-zalimin. And what a terrible abode it is for those people who do zulm. As for ru'b, as for the fear, the Prophet ﷺ said, I have been given 5 things which were not given to anyone else before me. I have been given 5 things which have not been given to anyone else before me. First of all, Allah made me victorious by awe. Allah has made me victorious how? By awe. By His frightening my enemies for a distance of 1 month's journey. Meaning even if someone is away from me, a distance of 1 month's journey, still he is terrified of me. And we see that the mushrikeen, although they had the power to come and attack the Prophet ﷺ and the Muslims, but they didn't have the confidence to do so. Secondly, the earth has been made for me and for my followers a place for praying and a thing to perform tayammum. Therefore, any one of my followers can pray wherever the time of a prayer is due. So the entire dunya, the entire earth is a masjid. Thirdly, the booty has been made halal for me, yet it was not lawful for anyone else before me. I had mentioned this to you earlier as well. Fourthly, I have been given the right of intercession on the day of resurrection. He will be allowed to intercede. Fifth, every prophet used to be sent to his nation only, but I have been sent to all mankind. So one of the things that were given to the Prophet ﷺ exclusively was rub, especially over his enemies. You know, you wonder that he stayed in Makkah for 13 years and the people opposed him so much. How come they didn't just have the strength to come up and kill him? They persecuted the companions so much, they killed an entire family, the family of Ammar, and they persecuted so many other companions, Bilal radiallahu anhu. But what is it that prevented them from persecuting the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to that extent? Yes, they did persecute him a lot, but to that extent they weren't able to because of the awe of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So what do we learn from this ayah? That one of the ways through which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helps the believers is by putting rub in the hearts of their enemy. And this is one of the greatest forms of nasr, one of the greatest forms of helping the believers. That your enemy is terrified of facing you. He doesn't have the guts to say anything to you. I was just thinking of something. You know, sometimes you go somewhere and because you have the hijab on, you have the niqab on, sometimes people are scared. And don't think of it as a negative thing. This is a positive thing. Also, we learned that shirk and major sins, they make a person fearful. They make a person superstitious. And iman makes a person confident. Let's listen to the recitation of these verses. Because life is full of difficulties, right? No matter what you're doing, you will face challenges. And it's a great blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that a person is going through difficulty in his way. Even if you were to sit at home, still you could get a cold and you could become sick. You will get tired after the whole day, even if you haven't gone anywhere. But it's a big blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that a person is suffering difficulty in his way. Why? Because everything that he suffers, every difficulty that he faces, and every time he does sabr, he is getting reward. He is getting rewarded. There is an ayah in the Quran in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِن تَكُونُوا تَأْلَمُونَ فَإِنَّهُمْ يَأْلَمُونَ كَمَا تَأْلَمُونَ. If you are suffering from pain in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then they, meaning your enemy, also suffers pain in their struggling against you. But what's the difference? وَتَرْجُونَ مِنَ اللَّهِ مَا لَا يَرْجُونَ. You are hoping from Allah what they do not hope for. So anything that you do in life, you will face difficulties. And if you have to face difficulty in the way of Allah, then be happy. Do shukr. That upon that difficulty also, there will be immense reward, inshallah. And if a person focuses on the reward, then facing the difficulty becomes much easier. Dealing with it becomes much easier. Provided that you focus on the reward. If you look at these verses, we learned that وَكَأَيِّمْ مِن نَبِيٍّ قَاتَلَ مَعْهُ رِبِّيُّونَ كَثِيرٌ. رِبِّيُّونَ are who? Knowledgeable ones. So a person who has knowledge, it reflects in his actions and also in his words. A person who has ilm, who has fiqh of the religion, then it shows. The knowledge is shown. How? In his actions and also in his words. Look at their actions. فَمَا وَهَنُوا وَمَا ضَعُفُوا وَمَا اسْتَكَانُوا. And then look at their words. That, oh Allah, forgive us for our dhunub and our israf. So knowledge is reflected in the actions of a person. What else do we learn? We all have weaknesses. Some kind of weakness. Sometimes we cannot stay awake for too long. Sometimes we can't go without eating for too long. Some people have problems with attention. They can't pay attention to something for a very long time. For them to sit for an hour is like, oh my God, we need a break. An hour and a half is a big deal, we need a break. So we all have weaknesses. But what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say to us? بَلِلَّهُ مَوْلَاكُمْ وَهُوَ خَيْرُ النَّاصِرِ Allah is your Mawla. And He is the best of helpers. Ask Him for help. He will assist you. And we learn about the importance of moderation. Even when it comes to working or learning the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or practicing the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what is moderation to do? What is required? Not less and not more. Because those who try to do more, they were discouraged by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And if you say that no, you have to do more, then are you saying that you're better than the Prophet? For the dunya, sometimes you try so hard and still you don't get it. Because وَمَنْ يُرِدْ ثَوَابَ الدُّنْيَا نُؤْتِهِ مِنْهَا But as for the akhirah, if a person strives for it, then inshallah, the reward is guaranteed. Provided that a person is also sincere. Similarly, if you focus on the akhirah, you get one and you get the other free. What else? At times of hardship, we should be careful about our actions. We should reflect upon what we have done. And we should also be very careful about what we're saying. Because sometimes if we start complaining, maybe Allah will take the tawfiq away from you. And life is difficult. There will be challenges, but don't complain. Don't say negative things. Because if a person starts to be negative, then it's up to Allah. And some fears are natural. Ibrahim a.s. also felt scared when the angels came. So some fears are natural, but a person should not be overcome by that fear.